that. So we're hopeful to get a few new songs that we learned that are that have some meaning and have some substance in that, and we're going to be working on that throughout the rest of the year. Let us join our hearts together in prayer. Almighty God, may the words of my mouth, the meditation of all of our hearts, be acceptable in thy sight, O God, our strength, our rock, and our redeemer. Amen. Our first scripture passage today is from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 1, verse 1, and then 10 through 20. Listen now as God speaks to us in God's word. The vision of Isaiah, son of Amos, which he saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem in the days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah. Hear the word of the Lord, you rulers of Sodom. Listen to the teaching of our God, you people of Gomorrah. What to me is the multitude of your sacrifices, says the Lord. I have had enough of burnt offerings, of rams and of fat, of fed beasts. I do not delight in the blood of bulls or of lambs or of goats. When you come to appear before me, who asked this from your hand? Trample my courts no more. Bringing on in Sabbath and calling a convocation, I cannot endure your solemn assemblies with iniquity. Your new moons and your appointed festivals my soul hates. They have become a burden for me. I am weary of bearing them. When you stretch out your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Even though you make many prayers, I will not listen. Your hands are full of blood. Wash yourselves. Make yourselves clean. Remove the evil of your doings from before my eyes. Cease to do evil. Learn to do good. Seek justice. Rescue the oppressed. Defend the orphan, plead for the widow. Come, let us worship. Come, let us argue it out, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be like snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall be like wool. If you are willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. But if you refuse and rebel, you shall be devoured by the sword, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. May this God's word speak to our hearts, our minds, our spirits. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I enjoy a good show. I don't go to Broadway very often, but I enjoy the times I've been there, or any time in a big city. There's some free time to try to get up a play or a musical. I love a good movie. Most of the ones I've seen in the theater now are animated, but on those rare occasions where I get to go, and Sarah and I get to go on a date night, and the theater's playing something that interests us, I love that. And most of the shows we watch clearly are on television, being streamed in our house or our living rooms. I love the spectacle every 4 years, and like many of you on Friday, I was watching the television, I was watching the opening ceremonies of the Olympic Games, and love to see the things, to hear the sounds, the parade of the nations. It's a wonderful show. It's at those times, it's interesting in Brazil, where many of us have heard the crises, I guess, or struggles with their Olympic Committee, but just for that moment, just for those few hours, everything feels right because everybody is enjoying the show. An administrator in Brazil said this week, he said, I hope this is a cure for the country's depression. It is a distraction for them. But the issue with shows is when they're over, and you have to go home. You have to go back to whatever reality is. Most of you live in the show-me state, but we all reside in a culture that is showy. A showy culture that tells us image is everything, and for many it does not matter whether or not something is right, it's whether it looks right. It's what kind of show can we put on, how we can present ourselves individually, as a matter of work, our family, or even sometimes in in the church. It's the appearance, we think, that matters, not the actual substance. And so we turn to Isaiah, and Isaiah is a huge book. It is a huge book of prophecy, and normally we only read it once a year at the beginning of Advent as the prophet is prophesying about the coming of the Messiah. We love these passages, right? We love passages about lions and lambs lying down together, and it's beautiful and it's familiar, but if we actually listen to Isaiah, there's a lot more stick than there is carrots. There is a lot more that you're doing wrong than God is going to heal you. And so we turn to this passage. It's all about the harsh words that God has no interest in show. God has no interest in appearance. God has no interest in how we try to present things to each other, present things to God. The Lord wants us to do right, not just to look right. This is really what Isaiah is talking about as we turn to our next passage in Luke chapter 12, verse 32 through 40. It's so much of we want the world, but God is offering us the kingdom. And as we're talking about the kingdom, I love it. I was going to mention this, but when Sam was saying, like, that bank's going to be around forever. The bank in heaven, and that's true. God's kingdom is around forever. That things on earth, they come and they go. Things we think are so important, they come and they go. They rise and they fall. They succeed and they fail. God's kingdom is eternal. Listen now as God speaks to us in God's word. Do not be afraid, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions, give alms. Make purses for yourselves that do not wear out, an unfailing treasure in heaven, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be as well. Be dressed for actions and have your lamps lit. Be like those who are waiting for their master to return from the wedding banquet, so that they may open the door for him as soon as he comes and knocks. Blessed are those slaves whom the master finds alert when he comes. Surely I tell you, he will fasten his belts and have them sit down to eat, and he will come and serve them. If he comes during the middle of the night or near dawn and finds himself, blessed are those slaves. But know this, if the owner of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have let his house be broken into. You also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. May this God's word speak to our hearts, our minds, our spirits. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. One of my favorite plays, at least favorite sayings in a play, because the truth of it is from William Shakespeare's As You Like It. All the world's the stage, and all men and women merely players. They have their exits and their entrances, and one man in his time plays many parts. Child and sibling, friend and spouse, teammates, parents, employer, employee, child of God. We all play different parts. We all sometimes wonder. That's what I always tell kids when I'm in youth group or in Sunday school. I tell them that all of us in our hearts are 12 or 13 years old. All of us in our hearts know the insecurity we start to feel at that time in our lives. We go through that too tall, too short, too skinny, too chubby, too this, too that. The world will never say you're good enough. And that's kind of the point. So we put on these masks, we put on these facades. We're told perhaps not to be ourselves, we're told to color inside the lines, and if it's not the way the world wants it, or some kind of authority wants it, then it is inherently wrong. Religion is not as you like it. It's not, we don't get to just create it on our own. But God tells us, the truth of God tells us they are eternal. It's not like the old Burger King ad, you remember this from the 1970s, hold the pickles, hold the lettuce, special orders. Notice that it's not going to be responsive, but it's a verb, right? But it says, that's kind of, and after that it says, The church is here to say you can't have it your way. You can't just do it on your own. You can't just pick and choose in the midst of the culture that says have it your way. The church says it's God's way and it's better. In a world where image is everything, perception is reality, it is righteousness and justice and peacemaking and kindness that don't get much airtime. These do not lead the news. We had the same when I was in college when I was working to broadcast drills with the NBC station. If it bleeds, it bleeds. It's saying something. If there is something that is violent, it's going to be off the newscast. You always try to finish it right with a good newscast, even though it always has a kicker at the end. Some good story about the squirrel water scheme or somebody doing something really nice. But the actual news is something that's wrong with the world. This is how we turn this up on its end. And I think we know that justice does not get much airtime because those things are hard work. And it's far easier in life to put on a show. It's far easier in life to get the facade of something than to actually be about the hard work of doing that. But when we do that, we don't just turn off God. We turn off other people to God, right? So that's one of the biggest complaints about Christianity. It's not Jesus. Everybody likes Jesus. If you don't love Jesus, most people like Jesus. It's the people that claim to follow Jesus. People that talk to hypocrites, or sometimes we all fit that model of people who wear two different faces, one at church, another in the community. And what happens there is we put on a show, people are repelled because shows hurt and shows repel. I reminded one of my favorites, maybe my favorite play of all time is Inherit the Wind. Some of you remember that, some of you might have already seen the show, but it's about the Skittles monkey trials taking place at the beginning of the last century. And Drummond is the, in many ways, as a Christian pastor, it seemed like the anti-hero, but I always resonated with him because he was one who was arguing for, against, in a sense, a fundamentalist religion and arguing for being rational. And he tells a story about Golden Dancer. So you might remember this story. She was in the big side window of the great store in Waveland, Ohio. I used to stand in the doorway and say to myself, if I had Golden Dancer, I'd have everything in the world that I ever wanted or needed. I was 7 years old and a very fine judge of rocking horses. Golden Dancer had a bright red mane, blue eyes, and she was gold. With purple swamps. So when the sun hit her skirt, she was a dazzling sight to see. But she was a week's wages for my father. So Golden Dancer and I always had a plate glass window between us. But let's see, it wasn't Christmas. It must have been my birthday. I woke up in the morning, and there was Golden Dancer at the foot of my bed. Ma had skimmed on the groceries. My father had worked nights for a month. I jumped on the saddle and I began to rock. And it broke. It split in two. The wood was rotten. The whole thing was put together with spit and sealing wax. All shine and no substance. And that's how I feel about that demonstration I saw tonight. That's all glitter. That's not the gospel that it might as well be. When I was reading this passage from Isaiah, I kept thinking about inheritance, and I kept thinking about this speech, about how much of our lives held together look nice by spit and sealing wax, but yet the inside is rotten. Now, we all want to put our best foot forward to look like we know we're doing it all the time. On Friday night, I was down on Springfield with our kids and Sarah, and we were eating dinner in one of these places in downtown where it has windows on all sides. We had a great booth where we could just watch people come and go. And I can't tell you how many people I saw taking selfies. And have you ever, how many folks have taken selfies? Nearly I appreciate it, honestly. And the rest of you who are my age or younger, we'll talk later about honesty as well. But you don't take a selfie. We're all familiar with this. You don't take a selfie and then look at it and say, oh, that was a good picture, but post-its. You keep taking them and taking them and taking them until you have the best picture possible. Nobody posts or reposts on social media something that doesn't make them look good. This is part of the tanks of our day. It's look at other people's lives, right? The facade of other people's lives. And it's always, it's not like I struggle with my children, or I struggle with my job, or I struggle with my spouse, or I struggle with my church. It's all sunshine and lollipops. Look at how great my life is. It's a show. It's a show. And God says, I'm tired of your shows. He says all these things up and down. He says your new moon festivals, your Sabbath festivals, all these things where you come out and you worship, you make loud noises, and you sing along with the band, and you do all these things. I'm tired of them. They're repugnant to me. I'm washing my hands of them because your hands are filled with blood. You're going to do that one way here, but our lives are different over here. We're trying to impress people. We're trying to get likes from people we probably don't even like. Real, true friends know your house is not always clean, and you welcome them in anyway. There's no need for makeup. There's that moving beyond small talk, right? When you first meet people, where are you from? What do you do for a living? That's the small talk. Real friendships, you can see them after many years and just cry in those arms or laugh at the lunacy of something. God doesn't care about selfies. God cares about how selfless we are. But how we take care of the widow and the orphan and the oppressed, about how we stand up for those who cannot stand at all. If our God is just a small talk God, then our God is going to be small. If our God is someone we try to appear good towards, then our God really isn't good. But our God is good, our God is big, and our God is powerful. And while we walk the world, God is saying, the kingdom is eternal. God's expectations for us are big, and this is why God sends prophets. This is why God says, I want to cut you off, but I can't. This is why God says, I'm frustrated with you, but I'm going to keep on holding on. Instead of truly seeing God, the people of Israel just wanted God to bless what they had already decided they're going to do anyway. And I do the same thing. We do the same thing. We say, like, God, that was all right, right? It's better to ask forgiveness than permission in our relationship with God and others. What Isaiah is saying is be yourself, be real. It's harder now than it ever feels like, but not really. It's just that our technology has changed. Remember when Jesus' day, when he saw the Pharisees, he called them whitewashed tombs, right? They looked good on the outside, but inside they were rotten. Inside they were dead or dying. In Isaiah's time, it's person told, I've had enough. I do not delight. It is futile what you are doing. It is, you are an abomination. I can bear it no longer. You have become a burden to me. The very first passage in this thing, or the second verse, verse 10, it says, hear the word of the Lord, you rulers of Sodom. Listen to the teaching of our God, you people of the world. And when we hear that in popular Christian culture, we hear Sodom, and we think, well, that has to do with homosexuality. We look actually at the Old Testament. It's talking about hospitality and the lack of hospitality that was going on in the Near Eastern world. That was the most important thing, because people were not welcoming others in. This was going on in Isaiah's time, and meant much of our own life as well. What good is a show if there is no substance? What good is a sizzle if there is no steak? What good is the hats if we have no cattle? What good is looking the parts if we're not acting the part? And so Isaiah says, wash yourselves. Make yourselves clean. Remove the evil of your doings from my eyes. Cease to do evil. Learn to do good. Seek justice. Rescue the oppressed. Defend the orphan. Plead for the widow. Be for the others. Have no one who is there for them. Sit with those people who have no one to sit with them. Stand with those people who have no one to stand for them. Then you might say, well, how do we do this? And the problem with any kind of sermon is, say, well, how do we turn this into action? The same thing we talk with the kids about making that list. There's small things about being kind. There's small things about busy people when they're sick, to go to the hospital, and there's small things about giving an unexpected smile or hug, but there's also inviting people to say that are wallowing in poverty and say, come and be a part of this program we're doing at church with the Financial Peace University. There's other things with cross lines and to look and not just to clear out your cupboards, but to go to the store specifically to buy food for cross lines and take it there and volunteer at Water Gardens or our children's game and the Lafayette House. There's so much need around us. But don't necessarily take a picture of it. Don't make a show of it. One of the unique things, and I know that missionary work is important, the short-term missionary work is important, but we don't go on mission trips to take pictures of ourselves with people we're serving. We've got to serve people. We don't go and do something right just so we can promote it or just so we can retweet it. We do it because that's what God requires of us. Finally, the Lord says to Isaiah, let's argue this out. One of the best passages in all Scripture. He says, let's argue this out. God basically says to the prophet, you're wrong. I'm not listening to you. I'm done with you. You got blood on your hands. And then the next thing he says, fine, let's argue it out. Let's fight. Let's wrestle like Jacob. Let's there's no hiding it. You know, some sins are very public, and those are the ones where we all point fingers, but we shouldn't. Because the difference between a private sin and a public sin is just how many people know. God knows them all. God sees them all. So don't put on the show. Don't pretend like you have everything all together. Admit that you are broken. Live lives that are broken, and then you can be fixed and redeemed. Be real with God and be blessed for action. And have your lamps lit. Be willing. Be obedient. God says, we'll eat of the good of the land. More than that. Glory to him. White as snow, white as snow. Though my sins were as scarlet, Lord, I know that I'm clean and forgiven. Through the power of your blood, through the wonder of your love, through faith in you, I know that I can be white as snow. Give up the world. Seek.